Blackstone Audio presents
Tales from the Ballpark, More of the Greatest Baseball Stories Ever Told by Mike Shannon. This book is read by Raymond Todd. Preface. The summer of 98 will always be easy for me to remember. As Mark McGuire and Sammy Sosa kept refocusing the nation's distracted attention on their Herculean assault on Roger Maris's suddenly ancient and vulnerable home run record, I couldn't manage a single base hit. No, I'm not that bad a hitter. It's that for the first time in almost 20 years, I didn't even get the chance to play fast-pitch softball. The year before, I had played first base for a team full of veteran fast-pitch players called the Miami Valley Merchants. The core of the team lived in the Dayton, Ohio area, but others lived in Hamilton, Cincinnati, and northern Kentucky. For the 1998 season, we had even recruited a shortstop who was going to drive from Pennsylvania to play with us every weekend. It was Joe Stevenson who called me with the bad news for the 1998 season. Joe was a burly, short-haired, good old boy from South Carolina. We met about 15 years ago when I was still running my own fast-pitch team. Joe had just moved to Fort Wright, Kentucky, his wife Gretchen's hometown, and the first thing Joe wanted to do was to hook up with a fast-pitch team. I didn't waste any time either. "Are you any good?" I asked him on the phone. "Just give me a tryout and you can decide for yourself," Joe said. It took me about 5 minutes to realize that Joe would be the best player on our team. He had all five tools. I'll never forget the first time we played together. It was the first game of a doubleheader in Georgetown, Kentucky. A Georgetown batter lofted a medium fly ball into dead center. Joe camped under it, caught it, and then dropped it. Back in the dugout, Joe announced to himself as much as to anyone else, "That'll never happen again." He said this not as an excuse or a hope or a fear, but as a simple fact, and I've never seen Joe drop another one. On the other hand, I've seen him make a lot of what ballplayers, both amateur and professional, love to call major league plays. The 1998 Miami Valley Merchant season was scheduled to open the weekend of Saturday, May 16th and Sunday, May 17th in Anderson, Indiana. We were going to play in the Reader Heating Classic. Earlier in the week, I had received a couple of phone calls from Jeff Hirschner and Brett Domasek, two of the Dayton guys who ran the team, double-checking to make sure I was going to make the trip to Anderson. I should have known something was up, but I was surprised when Joe called me Friday night and said, "You can sleep in tomorrow. We're not going to Indiana. We've only got 7 guys who are ready to go, so Jeff and Brett have decided to shut the whole thing down right now." So that was it. The Miami Valley Merchants were through for the season before it even started. All it took to dissolve the team, to wipe out the entire schedule, to cancel a summer's worth of weekend trips all over the state of Ohio, plus a couple of trips to neighboring states, were a few phone calls. It didn't seem right for such a thing to occur, for an enterprise as fun and wholesome as a competitive fast-pitch team full of serious, dedicated players, to be snuffed out so easily. But the sad truth is that we didn't really have a team full of serious, dedicated players anymore. I'm hoping, of course, that the demise of the Merchants is only temporary, that the team will be resurrected in 1999. I don't want to be party to the disbanding of another fast-pitch team. The team I'd organized and managed fizzled out after an 8-year run, during a humiliating weekend tournament pockmarked by no-shows and fill-ins coaxed out of the stands. 3 years later, I was a member of the last Hamilton Merchants squad, a team that, under a succession of different names, had been a well-known force in Ohio fast-pitch circles for more than 30 years. The Hamilton program, as he called it, had been run by Merle Phillips, a chain-smoking old fart who had been a great fast-pitch catcher in his younger days. In his managerial heyday, when the game was stronger, Merle had often been unable to control his acerbic tongue, and he had practically out-Steinbrennered the owner of the New York Yankees in the way he'd mishandled players and made ruthless and sometimes underhanded roster moves. On the other hand, Merle was an excellent judge of talent and character, and when he wanted to, he could charm the crudest barmaid into acting like the sweetest debutante. He often spoke in fast-pitch parables, declining to make his point directly, preferring instead to tell a long-winded story about some player or game from the past, so that the listener, if he had the sense to do so, could extrapolate the point of the story and apply it to his own situation. And always, his speech was a colorful mixture of homey expressions, archaic words, malapropisms, and fast-pitch proverbs. One of his favorite expressions meant to say we weren't going to talk a long time was, "There's no need for us to go up the hill and down the mountain, but we always did anyway." Merle loved to gather us into a huddle for a last few words of encouragement or advice, right before it was time for us to take our positions on the field.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.